Alright group, in this video we are going to be doing some examples of how to calculate the volume of a 3D figure by using a technique called plane slicing. Another term that gets thrown around a lot with this type of problem is using discs or washers, because that is the picture of the slice that we're going to be using. Remember that the area for a circle is pi r squared. The area for a washer would essentially be pi times the large, the outside radius squared, minus pi times the inside radius squared. So to get the volume for a particular slice, we could just multiply that area by either dx or dy as appropriate. We're going to be working three problems from problem set 5-9, numbers 6 and 8 and 14. So let's start with number 6. And to do this question, we're going to need a picture. So what we're going to be using is this graph right here. Take a minute, if you would, and read the question and see if you can generate this same graph on your calculator. So assuming that you have done that, read the question, you'll notice that R is the region bounded by the graphs of natural log of x and y equals 1. To sort of shade that in so you can see it better, it's basically this area here. You can see it's sort of an odd shape. It almost has a trapezoidal shape to it. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be rotating that particular area. In this case, we're going to be going around the y-axis. And so if you'll notice, if we were to draw the same graph and kind of go off into the other direction, we would end up hitting the graph right around here somewhere. And we would have a similarly trapezoidal shaped section here. And it would make the graph kind of complete. If we rotate that around the axis, it's going to look something kind of like this. Here's the bottom, I guess the top of it, kind of this inverted little, almost like a stool shape. And there's the other part. And you can think of this as being a series of disks placed on top of each other, stacked up vertically. And the smaller disks are at the bottom of the figure, and they get larger as you go up. So what that tells us is that because our disks are stacked vertically, that this is a dy situation, because the width of each of those disks is going to be measured as dy. We also know the radius of this particular circle that we're going to be using is this distance here. It's basically the distance from the y-axis out to wherever the graph happens to stop. So it could be here, could be here, could be here. It's always an x value. And so if we could get an idea of what x is, that's going to equal our radius, which we're going to do here in a minute. And we're also going to find out that the limits on y, which are going to become our integration limits, are from 0 to 1, because that's where our graph basically goes, is from 0 up to 1. Okay, so one thing we'll also notice here, the x is the radius. We have this relationship that we use to get y in this case, which is that it's equal to the natural log of x. Based on that, if I want to get x by itself in this equation, I would say that x is equal to e to the y. So we had just got x by itself by using some algebra. All right, so here's where we're going to go from this point forward. I'm going to get rid of this information, and we're going to start by trying to say what we've learned so far, that the radius is going to be x, or in other words, e to the y. We also know that in this particular case, we have a disk. And so all we need to do to get the area for the disk is take pi times the radius squared. Well, that's pi times x squared. We also know that because we're stacking these things up vertically, we would have that times dy to get the volume for each of the slices. So dv is going to be pi times x squared dy. Notice that this is a mismatch. In other words, we have x here, but then we have y here. We would like those to match. So what we need to do is express the function on the where we have everything underlined in red. That needs to be in terms of y. So that's where it comes in handy, that we have already solved this equation in terms of of x before, so we can replace it. So this is really going to be pi times e to the y squared dy, or pi e to the 2y dy. That's equal to dv. What we can then do is integrate both of those expressions. So the integral of dv, which is going to be the volume, is going to equal the integral of e to the 2y dy. And you'll notice I left out the pi there. Remember that the pi is a constant. It can either go inside the integral, or it can actually go in front of the integral. That's where I like to put it. But either way you look at it is fine. When we integrate this, remember that we are going to be integrating from the limits that y is taken on. The smallest y in the picture is 0. Biggest one is 1. So now this is going to be one of those situations where we're going to have a pi divided by 2. We're dividing by 2 because of the 2 that's here in e to the 2y. This 2 right here is created because of that. And that's going to be multiplied times e to the 2y. And we're going to evaluate that from 0 to 1. So now to get the volume, what we're going to be doing here is we're going to say it's pi over 2 times. We plug in a 1 into this expression, we get e squared minus e to the 0 power, which is just 1. And we could leave it like that because they did ask us for an exact value. If we plug this into a calculator, we get 10.036, which is the value of volume in this particular case. Okay? All right, so that's number 6. Let's clear this out of here. And then we're going to talk about number 8. So why don't you take just a minute and pause the video and read number 8. Okay, now in number 8, notice that we are given a figure, so we're not going to have to spend quite as much time wrapping our head around the picture, but we're going to make some observations about it. The first one is that this is a question involving washers. You can see the washer in the picture. You can also see that the washers are stacked up vertically. In this particular case, they would be stacked on top of each other, going up vertically. That implies that this is a situation where our integral is going to use a dy. If they were stacked horizontally, one next to the other, that would imply a dx situation. All right, so we're going to find the radius of the washer. In this case, the radius of the washer is going to equal, in the picture if you look at it, it's going to be x1 minus x2. So we would have to know those two quantities and subtract them to find the radius of the washer. For now, that's all we're going to say. We would also say that the area of the washer, like the base of each one, is going to be pi times x1 squared minus pi times x2 squared. So again, if we were going to write an expression for something like dv, we would be taking that quantity that we just wrote, the area, times the thickness or the height of each washer, which we have already said from up here is going to be dy. Now please do notice that we have a mismatch. We have x's and y's that cannot work. So what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to change it so that we can express these two x's here and here in terms of the corresponding y's. All that means is we're going to take the two equations that we were given in the first place and we're going to solve them for y. Okay, I'm going to get rid of this part. And we'll go ahead and solve those equations. There were two of them. We were given y equals x1 to the fourth. I just marked it as x1 because that's the equation that corresponds to the x that's marked as x1, and y equals 8 times x2. All we need to do to solve each of these for x is to, in the first case, take the fourth root of both sides or raise each side to the 1/4 power. So we'd say y to the 1/4 is equal to x1, and over here, y divided by 8 is equal to x2. So with those two pieces of information, now we can say that dV is going to be pi times, well, x1, that's y to the 1/4 power squared minus pi times y over 8 squared. So we're just replacing x1 and x2 with what they're equal to. And now when we put the dy on here, now we have a match. Okay? So let's clean this up a little bit. dv would be pi. And if I square y to the 1/4, I'm going to have y to the 1/2 minus pi. And in this case, I've got pi over 64, because I've got to square that 8, times y cubed over 3 dy. Everything's in terms of y, and it's simplified. So the next step, of course, is to actually take the integral of this side, take the integral of this side, and let's take a look at our integration limits in this problem. Notice in the picture that y ranges from a low of 0 to a high of 16. And so those are going to be the limits of integration in this case. So, all right, let's go ahead and integrate. So we're going to get v equals. Now what I did is I thought about taking the integral of the first part. And again, I like to move the constants out front. So this is what I ended up writing with my pi in the front, just to make a simpler problem for myself. And then I wrote a separate piece, pi over 64, same limits of integration. This time it's going to be y cubed, y squared, I think I integrated step too soon in that previous problem, that was my fault. So it should be y squared. I was thinking a step ahead already. So we're also going to put a dy on the end of that. So now when we integrate, actually take these two integrals, we're going to get the following expression. Well, here, when I take y to the 1/2 and integrate that, that's going to give me y to the 3/2 power. I would normally have to divide this expression by 3/2. I can also simplify it by multiplying by 2/3. So I've got pi times 2/3 times y to the 3/2 power, and I'm going to evaluate that from 0 to 16, minus pi over 64 times 1/3 times y cubed, also from 0 to 16. When we evaluate all this, we're going to get 2 pi over 3 times 64. And how do I get 64? Well, that's 16 to the 3/2 power. Or I could think about taking the square root of 16, which is 4, cube that, which is 64, minus pi over 64 times 3, whatever that is, which I didn't check, times 16 cubed. And notice that I'm not really worried about the limit of 0. That's simply because when I plug in a 0, I get 0 on either side. When you evaluate all this on a calculator, you're going to get 67.021. They told us that the units on both axes were inches, so we're going to say inches cubed, or cubic inches. And that's going to be the value of the volume in that case. Okay, we got one problem left, and that is problem 14. And in problem 14, it looks really complicated because it says, oh, we're with a different axis. But again, we're going to approach this one just the same way we did. We've got washers in this situation. And in this particular case, the washer, we could almost think about moving the axis right into the middle of this thing. We could handle it in the very same way. It would give us the same volume. So let's imagine this for just a minute. If I'm going to do this particular question, I still want to think about, I've got washers. This is number 14. I've got washers. I need to know if I'm going to stack them vertically or horizontally. I'm stacking them vertically because that's the way my circles would work. So I'm going to use a dy. I need the radius of the washer. Now the radius is basically going to be equal to the x value that's determined by the parabola in the picture. It's real skinny at the top, it's fat at the bottom. And it changes as we go. That's equal to, well, let's find out. Y is equal to 4 minus x squared is the relationship that relates x to y. If I solve that for x, I'd have to add x squared to both sides and subtract y. So I'd get y squared, or x squared, excuse me, equals 4 minus y. So x is the square root of 4 minus y. So in other words, the radius is also equal to the square root of 4 minus y. So far, so good. We also know that if we take the area of the washer, which is our usual next step, that's going to be pi. Well, let's see. The washer, if we think about moving that axis so it runs right down the middle of that thing, we know that the furthest away, the biggest radius we ever get, is basically a radius of 3. If we just found the radius of the whole cylinder that figure's kind of sitting inside, it would have a radius of 3. So we're going to say the area is pi times 3 squared, or 9 pi, minus pi times, well, it's going to be, in that particular case, x squared. Okay, so we can basically say, here's my x squared. And that's going to get multiplied when we write the volume, the dv, that's going to get multiplied. I'm just going to write it like this. We've already said this problem is a dy problem. And we've got this mismatch again. X is here, dy is here. We don't want those to be different one to be the same. So we're going to have to write a dv equals pi times 9 minus pi times. Now, if we take x from up in here and we square it, all that's going to happen is it's going to make the square root go away. We're going to have this nice expression. Okay. Now, if you clean this up, you're going to find out that dv is going to equal 9 pi minus 4 pi plus pi y dy. And all we're going to end up doing is we're going to integrate that, and the limits that we're going to integrate on are the limits on y. What does it change over? Well, it changes over from 0 to 4. So we're going to be integrating dv, and that's going to be the integral from 0 to 4. Let's see, we had 9 pi minus 4 pi, that's 5 pi minus pi times y dy. I would strongly suggest that you stop the video for just a minute and evaluate that integral. It's a pretty straightforward one, and see what you get. And I'll write the answer down below. When you have finished evaluating this, you're going to get a volume of 24 pi, or 75.398. So check your answer and see what you come up with for that. And that's our three examples.